Hello there, Roy here, and what you see behind me is a 7-in-1 villager setup, from producing their food all the way down to trading for emeralds. This 7-part villager setup also includes two new inventions for 1.16.2. It starts here at the automatic crop farm, then it moves into the automatic villager breeder, then into where the babies grow up, then into a automatic villager storer. Then from there we have an AFK villager price reducer. Then the villagers go into another storage, then into this villager job switcher, then finally into this amazing villager trading hall, which is very compact and has 3 villagers per slice, all while allowing them to access their workstations so they can refresh their trades. And don't forget to go ahead and subscribe, because I make tons of really cool, not only complex farms, but I also make quite a few simple ones. And I have a series where I'm trying to farm up every item in the game, from beets to beacons. Now there is 7 different machines here, but you can choose whatever one you need for your survival situation. There's a lot to go over, so let's get started. First up here is the automatic villager crop farm. This uses the design that Snorlax made for me. It's a very nice design. He went through 12 different designs, comparing a wide variety of shapes. And this one produced the most crops per hour. This is a double setup where there is 2 crop farms beside each other, sharing a single hungry villager. And the farmers go around, plant crops, harvest the fully grown ones, and then eventually come over here and try to give their extra crops to this villager. But when the villager does attempt to give crops to this villager, instead they hit this fence here and they just fall down into the water. All the crops are swept aside and dropped all the way down to the very bottom. Each of these towers produces 1,000 crops per Minecraft day. With 2 of them, it produces 2,000 per 10 minutes of daytime, as the crop farms only work in the daytime. The crops are then sent to these villagers over here. We have to keep them a little ways away so those villagers don't attempt to be attracted to these beds. This villager design is the same design I showed you guys back in 1.14.4. It still works, where the villagers are in pairs of 2 and they are close enough so any carrots that come into this water stream can get picked up by them and be shared to the other villager beside them. They also think they have access to all these beds because they think they can walk through the trapdoors and get to the bed, even though they cannot. And there's extra beds for the babies. For the villagers to breed, they just need to have 12 crops, as well as have access to 3 empty beds, 2 for themselves and 1 for their baby. These guys are ready to breed right now. This small villager setup here will produce 30 babies per daytime of Minecraft. Any excess carrots are taken to the far end where you can store them. It also could be potatoes, because potatoes work on those farms. Of course, above the villagers, and these villagers make sure we have lightning protection to avoid lightning strikes from converting villagers into witches. If you ever notice your villagers getting angry and not breeding, it might be because they didn't get enough food or their beds are occupied. Now, if they are getting enough food, there might be a problem with their beds. Sometimes other villagers think they own the beds instead of them. If you just come in here, break a few beds and replace them, then they will start working once again. And sometimes you'll have a villager that has high priority, so any carrots that come by, he'll be the first one that grabs them. The guys by the water are supposed to give it to the farther villager, but with his high priority, he will throw it to this guy and he'll be able to pick it up before this guy is able to pick it up. This usually gets fixed over time, so they don't have to worry about it. When the villagers do produce babies, they are standing on these fences, which allow the babies to slip in between here and fall down into the water. There's a baby going down in the water. We have some water moving systems specifically designed to move small mobs like babies. They're all transported over here. This is the area where they wait until they grow up. Because this farm can produce so many babies, we need to make sure there's plenty of room here so that when they do grow up, they don't clip through the walls. Instead, they get pushed towards the center, and then at that point, they'll be tall enough where they can reach the water. And once they grow up, they'll be tall enough to touch this water and will get moved over here. And this is a system where the villagers could be stored. We first align the villagers with these trapdoors here. Let me send them downwards. This next system here puts villagers in bunches of 24. This is the maximum amount of entities you can have in one area before they start taking entity cramming, which does a large amount of damage and would kill them. The way that this device here works, if I just go ahead and kill this villager here, it will open up a trapdoor at the very top here. So any new villagers coming into the system will be able to be lined up against this trapdoor here, then get pushed over here, fall into this little chamber. We turn on hitboxes by pressing F3 plus B. You can see the villagers are fitting between this cobble wall and this fence. very nicely. We're also getting lined by the trap doors in the back. This is important because we're using the weighted pressure plates, which are able to detect how many entities are actually touching them. But there's a bug with them that they only work if the entities are all in a similar area. This is where we have to keep the villagers in a small area so that it can actually read the correct number. Once there's enough villagers inside of the small hole, it will power this redstone here, which will flick this trapdoor downwards so the villagers can't fall into this hole. Now there's about 20 some villagers here, just under the number where they start taking damage. And these villagers will automatically be let down to the next layer, where these guys are at, as soon as these guys die. And you can make this system as tall as you want, so you can have individual sections holding 24 villagers each. This bottom section here is to pick up the villagers in minecarts. Minecarts come from this dispenser here, and they move past the villagers, allowing them to be automatically picked up. Button gets pushed, and then the villager moves over here in front of the zombie. This next section is dedicated to lowering the prices of the villager. In this previous video, I covered how if you cure a zombie villager, the villager which it turns into will be so proud that you helped him out that he will have all his prices reduced. You can actually repeat this process, allowing something that normally costs 64 emeralds from a villager to only cost one. So if you're planning on doing a lot of villager trading, this system is definitely very useful. But when zombies attack villagers, on hard difficulty, there's a 100% chance that they'll turn into this zombie villager. On normal difficulty, there's only a 50% chance, and on easy difficulty, there's a 0% chance. If you're playing on easy mode, you don't need this device at all. If you're playing on normal difficulty, some of your villagers may just end up dying. So if you're on normal difficulty, you might want a system that can detect if one of your villagers dies, and then recycles the minecart back into the backside. And that's what this system here is, to replenish the minecarts. This system here is designed to convert the villager over into a zombie 4 different times, which if you did on normal difficulty, you'd only have a 6% chance of a successful villager. So with that difficulty, it might just be worth only trying to cure it once or no times at all. I designed this for hard difficulty, as most people play this. And the way that it works is the villager comes into here, and the villager activates this tripwire, which is above him. Because villagers and minecarts sit up nice and straight, where zombies sit with the curved legs, so they're quite a bit shorter. This difference can be detected with this tripwire up above, which activates the pistons. If I go ahead and cure this guy, and if I speed it up, so we can watch this villager convert over. You can see the villager is tall and activates his tripwire. Then once he turns short again, it activates this dispenser, puts out a weakness effect arrow, which then gets shot at the zombie. It also shoots out a golden apple from this dropper here, and the player just sits here AFK by holding down right click. It takes about 3 to 5 minutes for a zombie villager to cure up to a normal villager. You can speed up the process by having beds or iron bars around him. It only speeds it up by a little bit. Let's go ahead and convert him over again. You can see he'll turn tall again, he activates the system. When he turns short again, activates again, shoots the arrow, drops the apple to the player. The system automatically brings in a new villager, so you can just AFK here in survival, and you just face forward holding right click. Now I'll show you what it looks like when you're in survival. You don't actually eat the apples. As long as you're holding right click, as soon as you get the apple, you just give it to the guy in front of you. Now this is actually a modified version of the system that we designed during our Twitch stream. Now the original design that we made for this was using waterways to move the villagers between zombies and curing systems. But with a new change that they added to 1.16.2, it's now possible for villagers to convert into zombie villagers and back again, all while not leaving their minecarts. This allowed us to modify our old AFK villager curing system and make this a new one here. Thanks to everyone who joined our testing streams. Those are every Wednesday right after the new snapshots come out. And the world where we test stuff is open to the viewers, so it's a great way for you guys to participate in upcoming builds. We also decided to use the weakness arrows rather than potions. You can use either. It's because these you can get automatically from My Hero of the Village raid farm. Now the gold apples do have to be crafted. There's no way to farm them automatically, but it's not too difficult with a tree farm and a pigment gold farm. So after the villager has been converted 4 times, then what will happen is he will be moved onwards into this storage chute here. This is where he can finish converting, and they can easily stack up as high as you want. This is a great way to store villagers inside of minecarts. And this zombie here won't be able to attack villagers below them or villagers that happen to cure faster than him that end up on top of him. The cobwebs in here are just to prevent fall damage when he hits the very bottom. So just put them every 7 blocks or so. They'll just finish curing inside of there. This next part is dedicated to switching a villager's profession. Let's go ahead and push a button. It'll drop only down one villager. Then he'll be in front of this workstation. This will allow him to make this as his profession. Now, if we right click him, we can see how the price reducer worked really great. You can see that his price got reduced. Instead of costing 20 some of these crops to make one emerald, it only costs one crop to make one emerald. The purpose of this device here is not only to switch out their profession, but also to switch out what type of trades they have for the very first slot. You can only do this if you have never traded with the villager. So this is a new guy. You can see he's never been traded. He has no experience across this XP bar at the top, and he is a novice. But quite a few villagers have the first trades random. So like the farmer here, he could also had a chance of getting potatoes or selling bread. But this device here, we can easily make him switch. So he has different types of trades. Just like that, you can see now we actually have the bread trade and also the potato trade. We can go ahead and do it again. And you can see he has different trades. You have a beet trade and a wheat trade. This is very useful when looking for a very precise first trade. Let's say you have a carrot farm like we have up there. Well, we obviously don't want these type of trades, because if we would continue to trade with him, he would actually never get the carrot trade, because it only opened up so many trades per professional level. Then we just keep pushing this button and allowing him to switch until we get what we're looking for. Now, not all villager professions have multiple trades in their first level. We put together a little illustration here. All the occupations on top here are all ones that have more than two variations of items for their first trades, meaning that if you remove their workstation and bring it back again, they have a chance of switching it up. But of ones that can actually have multiple trades, not all of them can be pushed by piston. So these here, you can automatically push the button to move it back and forth, where these you actually have to remove it using a tool and then place it back down again. And you can see all the different workstations down here and which ones can be pushed and which ones cannot. A general rule of thumb is if an item can set inside of a block, it usually cannot be pushed by a piston. Now there are some exceptions, like items don't sit inside of the grindstone here, but they still can't be pushed. If you're wondering what all the different things that villagers can offer you, I went into great detail about that in this video here, which you can find linked below. Once you have a villager that has a trade that you want, you go ahead and just purchase one so that he can no longer lose his occupation. Now you can go ahead and put this guy into your villager trading hall. So if I just press this button here, he's going to come over here and he's going to find an opening, and then he will be placed down into it. He happens to be in the third slot, so it automatically closes so that the next villager gets moved over to the next one. And depending on what occupation the villager is, make sure you put his appropriate workstation right here so he can have access to it and refresh his trades. Now with this trading hall here, you have access to all these villagers from one position. So I can trade with this guy up here, I can trade with this guy, I can trade with this guy down here, I can even trade with the ones to the side. You can access a lot of villagers all from not even moving. And this is how we actually have it set up on Prototech, where we have villagers stacked three high so that we can access many villagers without moving around that much. Now, it did take me quite a while to make this actually work, because the villagers are very weird when they are searching for a workstation. They sort of need to think that they're standing on ground in order to work. And this is the only way you can refresh the villager trades. The way I pull this off is I have fence gates inside of their feet here, and that way they think they're like standing inside of a block. And only then will they start working. So I have that for this layer as well as this layer. This guy is already standing on a block, so he has no problem working over here. The design itself is very compact. You can see it's only six blocks across, and you can actually mirror this on the other side and share this block, where it would only be 5.5 blocks, making a very compact as well as easy to access villager trading hall. The way that works is that when the villagers come in a minecart, they will end up dropping down here, then they butt up against this block, which sends them backwards. They come into the curve rail, they come into this descending rail, which pushes them this direction again, or they butt up against it, then they go over here and they continue this until they find a spot that's open. Once they find a spot that's open, they will fall down this hole here, hitting this tripwire, which will flicker each of these gates, allowing the minecart to fall through both the gates and end up at the very, very bottom. Let's go ahead and watch this. Just push this guy, and you can see he will activate tripwire, activating the gates, and ends up on the very bottom. The next guy will also activate all the gates, but since the villagers don't actually stand on the gates, it doesn't really matter. The gates are just there to occupy their feet. So this next guy will also go through all the gates. He's really sitting on top of this villager's head. If you do F3 plus B, you can see his minecart sitting on top of his head. And if we put in one more villager, you see he will finish it off by standing inside of the tripwire, which keeps this piston extended. That way no more villagers come down into the section. Also notice that we can put in villagers that have no occupation, and if there's a workstation near them, they will choose that workstation. In 1.16.2, they fixed a bug where villagers were trying to choose workstations that were kind of far away, and now they do a much better job at choosing the closest one. You can see this guy is a librarian, this guy is cleric, librarian, cleric, librarian, cleric. And notice that all these guys here that I put in actually never got traded with, so they can choose whatever occupation they want. But because they fix a bug, they're really, really good at choosing the closest one. You can see all these guys line up perfectly with the occupations behind them. But if you don't send them through the villager trade reducer, you can see they might have really expensive trades. And that's why it's very important to use that device. You get this down, but that's only one emerald and a book. You get an efficiency 5 book. Very, very useful. Now, since these guys never been traded, they can lose their occupation for short periods of time and regain them. So if you see something that has a good trade that you want to keep, make sure you do trade with them. Otherwise, like that guy there, you see he lost his trade for a second and he regained it. With the workstations in the back, it makes it very easy for you to click on all the villagers without them being in the way. And since you already went ahead and chose the occupations that you want, you're guaranteed to be satisfied with their first trades. Now, obviously the best trades from villagers are towards the end of their trade list, which take quite a while to unlock. It might take several days to gather enough XP's for the villager to unlock the very lowest ones. And because it takes so much effort to get some of the best trades in villagers, you don't often really kill them once you get them to like the master level. And that's why I didn't make any automatic way to kill these guys. But you rarely might come across a situation where you have like two guys that kind of come out with the same trades at the end, and you don't want extra guys, so you want to remove them. So if I would go ahead and hurt one of these villagers, you can see that their prices will increase because they've seen you kill a villager near him. Even if you kill the villager with a single hit. If you think you need to kill some villagers, you have to do it using natural means, so like fire or lava. That way the game doesn't associate your play with the thing that killed the villager. And you can do this by shift-clicking the lava up against their workstation in the back, and then removing it shortly after so it doesn't flow outwards to the other villagers, just like that. And you can repeat the process if you want to speed up the villager dying. And you can do this with any of the villagers, like the ones on the bottom. You can also remove their minecarts by flicking this lever here, which opens up trapdoors, and just breaking it. Now, in order to use the lava method, you have to make sure that the bottom layer here is 3 layers of snow. I'll keep the villagers low enough so that you don't accidentally break the minecart with the lava, which is not a good thing because then the villager will pop off and bump the other villagers to the side. The downside to having snow layers down here versus having the daylight sensors is the daylight sensors, you can put hoppers underneath. So any items that happen to fall into the villagers can get picked up and placed over here into this chest. But you cannot place snow layers on top of hoppers. Also, when you kill like a lower villager, the villager above will fall down into its place. That's because it will update the tripwire, which will make the gates all flicker. Now, if you're very picky about what type of trades you have in your final villager trading hall, you might want to set up a separate trading hall in between this and that piece. That way you can kind of like fully open up their trades and see what they have before putting them into a more permanent trading setup like this one. And this is kind of what we did on Protek. So let me show you guys that. So here's Protek Villager Island. This is how we have our setup. We have our crop farm over here. Then all the crops are sent around over through this waterway. It goes around the backside here, and then it goes into a massive villager breeder, which I think has like 600 villagers. And when these things produce babies, they go downwards and you take in through this water stream over here and up to our villager judger. That's what all this redstone stuff is here. We actually have two villager judgers here. Now this is set up for version 1.12, which is a little bit different because whatever profession the villager has when he's born, he's going to always have. So the judger here is where we decide if we want to keep that villager to do further trading with him. In this version, we keep a lot of librarians as well as blacksmith. And then what we do is we send them into our trading hall here. The trading hall is the area where we open up their trades to see if they make the cut. We are also going for perfect villagers, meaning we're trying to get every profession that has the cheapest trades for the player. And we're also looking for some very useful blacksmiths, as there is a rare chance of you getting some very nice enchantments on diamond armor from them. Now we open hundreds and hundreds of these villagers, but only a few of them actually make it into our final trading hall. So from here, if we want to kill them, in this version, we can actually just kill them with the axe, or we can push a button and they'll be sent down to a killing chamber. There's also a lever we can switch so it ends up saving them. They all end up at this side here, and then they go over here if they're going to be kept. This is where we put our extra ones. And then the very, very best ones end up here in our trading hall. And you can see these are also stacked three high, which makes it very useful to reach them very quickly. We also came in here and name tag these to show the main thing that they are selling. But you can also come in here with signs and kind of illustrate the different stuff that they are selling. That's something you're going to have to decide if you want to have kind of like two trading halls, one to open them up and one to kind of store them permanently. Because in a trading hall like this, it is quite long. I think this one's 100 blocks long. It has two sides, so in the end you might be running between some really far locations just to enchant your gear. If you choose to use the snow layer variation, you do have to be careful not to put light sources near it so it will melt. Having that lava source there just for a split second could make it bright enough so the snow melts, but because it's only there for a short period of time, it's highly unlikely it ever melt because it only depends on random ticks. Make sure to spawn proof everything on all of these devices as well as make walls around it so no zombie can walk into the system. It's really important that you take the time to make sure zombies can't access any of your villagers. Now if you do build this training hall, it is important that you build this having it face the north or south direction. This has to do with how minecarts push each other. So if I just grab a rail here, I can demonstrate it. If you have minecarts that are on a rail and they are east and west of each other, you see they push each other apart. But if they are on rails that are north to south, they don't push each other apart. But with mobs inside of minecarts, it's a little bit different. And as long as they come in from this rail system here and get pushed up against the side and drop straight in, and you don't bump them, they will sit in here nice and perfectly in line with each other. Now having these fence gates turned this way also makes it so they can't really get pushed over into the other sides. And if you are using fences, make sure to use the ones that don't burn if you're going to put lava beside them. Now that this is the new nether variations, you can also use trap doors in there too. They're a little bit harder to click on in case you want to open up to drop down a villager. So it's really up to you how you want to customize this for your liking. These levers here are just to keep the trapdoors upright. It makes it look a little nicer and also allows you to easily access all the villagers. And the levers aren't really in the way as you're aiming like here to click on them. And these levers aren't really in the way either because they're lower than where you normally click. If you happen to accidentally click them, it's not a big deal. They're not really doing that much. I'll show you guys how to put in these rails. The rails can be kind of annoying to place in when you're placing north to south. So to do the ones back here, make sure you start with these rails in the back, place them all in. Those are just temporary. Then you place a rail here, and then you place the last rail there. Then you come in the back and remove all of this scaffolding. So to do these, you also want to put in some scaffolding over here and start the rails there and then continue going this direction. Then right here, we need another curved one like that one. You do that just like so. And then you can come in with another one like this. And then you put these two in like that. Then you put in this rail, which curves over this direction. Then you can place in this rail here. Then to place in this last rail, you put a scaffolding block there, place a rail here, and then there. And then this is how you get this shape. But the scaffolding block, leave that in until you're done with all of the other curved rails. That way this one doesn't try to turn. If you're not sure, just go ahead and practice a little bit in creative before doing it in survival. Then you come in and remove the scaffolding blocks and rails. 7 unique machines to completely automate villagers. And remember guys to go ahead and share this video with your favorite Minecrafters so they can implement these cool designs into their world, as well as leave a like on the video. If you guys like to build up any of these machines, the world download is in the description and you can see how they work block for block. I did design all this for vanilla Java, so if you have any problems, make sure you're actually playing that. I would like to thank you guys for watching. I'll see you guys in the next one. Bye bye. Villager, are you supposed to be wearing your pajamas? I don't think it's casual Friday. Oh, that's better.